Hachette Audio presents A Brief History of Paris, written by Cecil Jenkins and read by Roger Davis. Introduction. Nothing could have demonstrated more clearly the continuing significance of Paris than the worldwide reaction to the disastrous fire at Notre Dame in 2019. The more dramatic, since the flames could be seen on television lighting up the night sky, it brought forth immediate messages of sympathy from religious and political leaders across the world, along with pledges of contributions towards the reconstruction, which President Macron intended to see completed within 5 years. For the shocked Parisians, believers or non-believers, seen staring or weeping on the riverbank, this was a central icon of their identity, the guarantee of the continuity of their city since the Middle Ages. This was where Louis IX entered barefoot with his sacred relics, where Henri IV converted to the Catholic faith in order to unite the country, where Napoleon and Josephine were crowned, where General de Gaulle ended his triumphal march down the Champs-Élysées after the liberation of Paris. For the world at large, this was not only an internationally significant example of Gothic architecture, but a symbol of the central role that France has played in the political and cultural life of Western civilization. And the components of that historic role are on view on both sides of the river that has occupied a mythical place in the Parisian imagination, as captured in La Seine, the old song associated with Josephine Baker, among others, which sees the river as feminine and Paris as the male lover. Car la Seine est une amante, et Paris dort dans son lit. For there is indeed a remarkable concentration of significant sites on each bank of the Seine in central Paris. Take a ride on one of the riverboats, and on the left bank you find the once maligned Eiffel Tower, the Invalides with its handsome dome, beneath which lies the tomb of Napoleon, the Musée d'Orsay with its rich collection of Impressionist and Post-Impressionist paintings, Notre Dame with its façade at least spared the scaffolding, the Jardin des Plantes containing the important National Museum of Natural History, and the enormous ultra-modern National Library, the Bibliothèque François Mitterrand, also originally maligned but being gradually accepted. On the right bank, returning westward, you find the Conciergerie, where aristocrats spent their last days before execution, the Louvre, once the Royal Palace and now the most visited museum in the world, the Place de la Concorde, where once Madame Guillotine awaited the tumbrils from the Conciergerie, the Grand Palais built for the Universal Exhibition of 1900, and the Palais du Trocadéro, with the esplanade on which Hitler did a delighted little jig following the fall of Paris in 1940. This concentration of places of interest also makes Paris a manageable city for the walker. It should take little more than half an hour to walk, say, from the Luxembourg Gardens to the Place de l'Odéon, continue down the Rue Mazarin to the Institut de France, where the Académie Française holds its sessions, and along the quays past the bouquinistes selling their old books and parchments, to cross the river and stroll through the Place du Carrousel, between the Louvre on the right and the Tuileries Gardens on the left, to arrive at the Palais Royal, and then, if you are not too distracted, continue up to the Opéra. At every stage, as you notice some detail of an old building, or look along the Triumphal Way through the Tuileries Gardens to the distant Arc de Triomphe, you are walking in history. And you may be following in distinguished footsteps, for there has long been a Parisian myth of the flâneur, or stroller. The novelist Honoré de Balzac was a notable flâneur, even if he was often evading debt collectors, as was the poet Charles Baudelaire, even if it was a way of confirming his feeling of alienation from modern life, and of course another was the surrealist André Breton, who had a magical view of Paris, and saw it as the mysterious mirror in which to find the self. And this concentration of places of interest, together with their architectural variety, ranging from medieval to ultra-modern, is expressive of the fact that Paris historically has been more rounded than other Western capitals and has combined a wider range of areas of excellence. As one writer puts it, Paris was simultaneously a capital of the arts, politics, religion, finance, administration, and science, especially medicine and physiology. This connects with the long-standing belief, which lingered into our own time, with the idea of a cultural exception, that France had a universalist destiny. President Chirac stated it clearly enough in his last official address of 2007, when he declared, "France is not like other countries. It has special responsibilities inherited from its history and from the universal values which it has contributed to forging." The belief goes back to the fusion of church and state under Louis IX, or Saint Louis, in the 13th century. He had acquired what he took to be the original crown of thorns and fragments of the true cross. He had built the magnificent Sainte-Chapelle to accommodate these precious relics. He had protected his independence from the Vatican, sanctified his own kingship, and made France the equal of Rome or Byzantium. And since Paris was then the largest city in Europe, he had made it the cultural, spiritual, and political capital of the continent. For Louis XIV, in his Grand Siècle of the 17th century, France was the modern equivalent of ancient Rome. It represented the summit of civilization, and as its God-anointed ruler, he had the responsibility of creating the perfect society. At bottom, of course, he was rather unsure about Paris, and he built his own glittering mini-capital at Versailles, where he could exercise total control of the ballet-like formality of the autocratic society there. But he could rely on his formidable chancellor, Cardinal Richelieu, to bend the country to his vision of a completely ordered classical society and culture controlled by the state. So we have the new Académie Française regulating literature and language, along with an insistence on classical order in everything, from architecture to garden design. In the great neoclassical tragedies, which represent the cultural high point of this period, we have the imposed unities of action, place, and time. And it is striking that the desire of this society to see itself in terms of the eternal leads it, a century after Shakespeare had been presenting historical British figures on stage, to seek its self-image in plays about the ancient world. In the 18th century, as society evolved and faith began to give way to belief in human reason, Paris became the international capital of the Enlightenment. It was all very civilized, since the philosophes met regularly to engage in polite discourse in the elegant salons of aristocratic ladies, such as Madame de Tonsin in the Rue de Richelieu, or Madame Geoffrin in the Rue Saint-Honoré. They were a varied group of thinkers, including the political philosopher Montesquieu, the scientist Fontenelle, and the dramatist Marivaux, as well as those operating in several fields, such as Voltaire or Diderot, not to forget foreign visitors such as David Hume, Edward Gibbon, or Thomas Jefferson. The emerging ideas of evolutionary history and progress were then taken up, rather less politely, as the century wore on, in the new cafes that were springing up, such as the Procope, which you can still visit today, or the Café du Parnasse. With the royal order failing perceptibly under the burden of debt and a succession of weak kings, and with the American War of Independence opening up a larger perspective, the discussion over the new craze for drinking coffee became excitable to the point that the historian Jules Michelet thought that this powerfully cerebral, strong black coffee might just have something to do with the French Revolution. Black coffee apart, Paris has above all been the capital associated with the idea of revolutionary change. It was the stage on which the major social and political dramas of the Western world have been played out, even beyond the glorious revolution of 1789, which Lenin was using as a template and almost a timetable for the Red Terror in Russia as late as 1918. It raised great questions. Was the revolution inevitable? If it led to the terror and the guillotining of its own leaders, was that inherent or because of opposition from the rest of Europe? Was Napoleon the saviour or the betrayer of the revolution? The lack of a clear resolution led to aftershocks, starting with the 1830 revolution, which brought a switch to constitutional monarchy, but provoked the failed working-class Paris uprising of 1832, described by Victor Hugo in Les Misérables. It was followed by the 1848 revolution, which broke out simultaneously in several parts of Europe, but succeeded only in France, with the setting up of a republic, a success ironically negated by the fact that the introduction of universal suffrage merely brought in another emperor in the form of Napoleon III. The revolutionary story came to an end with the tragic episode of the Commune, when Parisians tried to establish self-government following the humiliating defeat in the Franco-Prussian War of 1870-1871 and were ruthlessly put down in a sad start to the Third Republic. None of this turbulent history prevented Paris from emerging as the world capital of fashion and luxury goods, which had originated with Louis XIV himself. In his fabulous ermine-lined robes and the red high-heeled shoes which he designed himself, and which conveniently concealed his shortness, he was not only exerting social control, but deliberately promoting French fabrics, jewellery, and fine furniture. The fashion trade then moved steadily from royalty to the aristocracy, from the personal designer, such as Marie-Antoinette's Rose Bertin, who made a fortune, to the group designer, and eventually, when the department stores opened up in the 19th century, to the upper bourgeoisie and the international market. As the trade expanded, so did the variety and increasing eccentricity of costume and hairstyles. To a degree, this reflected the situation of higher-level women at a time when they had no real legal rights and when marriage was a contract between families rather than between individuals, so that men had mistresses and women competed by being decorative and fashionable, even at the cost of uncompromising corseting. As the market broadened socially, it spread through an army of designers such as Poiret, Lanvin, and Schiaparelli, until it arrived at Coco Chanel's little black dress, although there was a return to tight-waisted luxury following the Second World War with Christian Dior's new look. Yet fashion was only one aspect of Paris, as it became the international capital of the high life and pleasure in the late 18th and the 19th centuries. Another that came down from royalty was fine cuisine. Louis XVI had his own personal cook in the conciergerie and was well fed when he mounted the guillotine, and many of the highlights of modern gastronomy, from sauce mornay to crepe Suzette, were created in Paris in the 19th century. Another highlight for the beau monde was the opéra, where it was important to be seen, and where you studied the other boxes through your opera glasses to see who was with whom, and be suitably shocked, or not, by the disreputable goings-on that sometimes occurred there. And that was not even the more popular opéra comique, or the many café-concerts, or the cabarets that would spring up in Montmartre. For at the heart of this fusion of entertainments, in a world where an actress could routinely be a courtesan or a waitress a prostitute, was the quest for sexual pleasure, so that from the late 18th century through the Belle Époque to the 1920s, Paris was an international centre of self-indulgence. This is where the overweight Edward VII, when Prince of Wales, came to have his needs met on his specially designed love seat, an elegant but slightly mystifying two-level contraption, and where many of the lost generation of American writers of the 1920s, also drawn by the cheapness of the post-war franc, came to enjoy sexual freedom. This heady mixture of revolutionary change, fashion, and pleasure fed directly into the art of the period. Painters and writers were involved in the Commune or the Dreyfus Affair, as in the parallel and important theoretical battles over realism or naturalism in painting and literature. And just as the monarchy had always supported French art with commissions, so subsequent imperial and republican administrations supported it as a national resource. The Académie des Beaux-Arts, founded in 1795, provided professional training for local and foreign artists. There were regular salons or exhibitions, and of course the various Expositions Universelles, notably those of 1878, 1889 and 1900, provided a window for French art. Moreover, just as governments from the Revolution to the Republic centralized political, administrative, and educational structures in Paris, so the city became the essential home of French art, and indeed the capital of world art in the 19th and early 20th centuries, until the market moved to New York after the fall of France in 1940. So many of the terms used in art come from French, such as naturalism, impressionism, symbolism, cubism, or surrealism, just as our image of Paris itself is still conditioned by the paintings of Manet, Renoir, Degas, Toulouse-Lautrec, or Caillebotte. Yet this blend of art, fashion, and pleasure, against the background of revolutionary change, is not all that Paris signifies. If you walk back down from the Opéra, assuming you have not just lingered in the arcades of the Palais Royal, and stroll through the Tuileries Gardens, noting the golden statue of Joan of Arc on horseback as you go, you might cross back over the river by the elegant iron footbridge, named after the former Senegal president Léopold Senghor. There you will find a man selling padlocks for the use of lovers wishing to symbolize their union by attaching this love lock to the many already covering the sides of the bridge. It started on the Pont des Arts, moved in 2015 when the weight of so many padlocks threatened the bridge, and testifies to the mythical belief that this historic city is also the capital of romance. And indeed, especially on a balmy night, with the reflections of its bridges and its illuminated ancient buildings shimmering in the river, it provides a compelling setting for so many love songs, such as Sous les Ponts de Paris, and a whole range of films from Les Amants du Pont Neuf to Woody Allen's Midnight in Paris. But if the Seine, as one writer testifies, is ideal for seduction, its power goes beyond that. In fastening their love locks to the bridge and throwing away the key into the water flowing below, those couples are seeking to lock symbolically into their union not just the beauty of this ancient city, but its durability over time. Paris, for many generations now, has also been the capital of love. Chapter 1. The emergence of Paris. So, what's in a name? What associations does it carry? And where did the Parisii, as the first Parisians were known, come from? Were they, as the 15th century monk Regard argued, survivors of the siege of Troy, who settled around some islands of the Seine and named their new capital after Paris, the lover of Helen? Or was it not rather, as an early 16th century scholar maintained, that they were descended from the Parisians of Arcadia in ancient Greece and might have sought to emulate the mythical Heracles, known to the Romans as Hercules? More simply, as another authority maintained, did not the noble and triumphant city of Paris derive its name from a temple to the Egyptian goddess Isis, giving Par Isis and thus Paris? And these are only some of the attempts to give a proper legendary status to what was increasingly seen as a city now rivaling ancient Rome in its grandeur and importance. However, there was also the little problem that this settlement of the Celtic tribe known as the Parisii only became known as Paris in the course of the 4th century AD, having previously been known variously as Leucotosia or Leucoticia, rendered in French as Lutèce or as Lititia to the Romans. This again was conscientiously confronted by the authors of two rival works that appeared in the same year of 1575 with the same resounding title of Cosmographie Universelle. While François de Belforest maintained that Lutèce took its name from an early king named Luce, André Thévé argued that it was drawn rather from the Greek word leukos, meaning white, and referring to the limestone used on Paris buildings. Although the great satirical writer Rabelais suggested wickedly that the reference was to the whiteness of the thighs of the city's women. And if neither of these explanations worked, might it not just be that the reference was to a cult of Leucothea, the Greek goddess of the foam, who saved Odysseus from drowning in Homer's Odyssey? In short, there was some reluctance to contemplate the mundane probability that Paris derived its name from the Gaulish word par, meaning boat, and that the notoriously boggy Lutèce derived its name from the Celtic word leuco, meaning marshland. You could hardly tell proud Parisians that their name was mud. Yet this muddy site on the Seine was the making of Paris, even if the only lingering echo of marshland today is the name of the formerly derelict but now fashionable district of Le Marais. Wider and flowing faster than today, the river at this point had a scattering of marshy islands, which have over time been consolidated into the two that we know today, the Île de la Cité, on which stand such signature buildings as the Sainte-Chapelle and the Cathedral of Notre-Dame, and the smaller Île Saint-Louis. Apart from the obvious advantages that it made it easier to cross, that it offered a plentiful supply of fish, and that it made it possible to set up a more easily defended fortified settlement on the main island, this would enable the site to become an important crossing point for both north-south land traffic and east-west river traffic. At a time when there was no developed road system and when the land was heavily forested, the river was important for moving both people and goods. Among the traces of settlements discovered in 1991, apart from a range of tools and ceramic objects, there is a long pirogue, or dugout oak canoe, dating from around 4500 BC, which is now on display in the Museum of Paris, the Musée Carnavalet. By 750 BC, in the Bronze Age, the Seine had become the essential conduit for the shipping of tin, a necessary ingredient in the production of bronze, from Cornwall to the copper-rich regions in South and Central Europe. And by the time the Parisii had settled into the area, around 250 BC, the tolls for crossing the wooden bridge and for passage along the river would enrich the settlement to the point that it was minting its own gold coins. The Celts were a loose collection of tribes originating in Central Europe that shared a similar language and similar religious and cultural traditions. The Senones tribe, of which the Parisii were a subgroup, had sacked Rome itself in 390 BC and only with difficulty been driven out. By the 3rd century BC, they controlled much of northwest Europe and had moved into the British Isles. Since the Romans called them the Galli, or barbarians, and since they also referred to them as the hairy Gauls, because they wore their hair long, it is ironical that our knowledge of the Gauls, since they left no written records, should be so dependent on the picture presented by their enemy, Julius Caesar, in his Gallic Wars. Caesar, of course, had his own political agenda, and a more nuanced and sympathetic treatment may be found in some recent studies. Nevertheless, Caesar's analysis of their society is clear and systematic. He observes two privileged classes exercising control, the Druids and the Knights. The Druids are normally the more powerful in that they control the worship of gods, such as Mercury, Apollo, or Jupiter, conduct public and private sacrifices, and arbitrate on all disputes. The Knights are professional warriors, entitled to the spoils of their battles, and like the Druids, exempt from any tax or obligation. All other members of the tribe have no say and may be treated as vassals, while men exercise absolute control over wives and children. The general weakness of Celtic society, in Caesar's view, was that there was a lack of central control, both within the constellation of different tribes and within the individual tribe itself, which rendered them vulnerable. And what followed would prove him right. Campaigning with his army in Gaul between 58 and 53 BC, the ambitious Caesar's mission was at least ostensibly to protect the area from incursions by the Germanic tribes. He convoked a gathering of delegates from the various tribes at Lutèce in the summer of 53 BC and asked them to contribute money and troops towards his campaign. Suspicious of his motives as they were, they made a formal offer of some cavalry units, but then conspired with other tribes to join in a general uprising against the Romans, led by Vercingetorix in the following year. When Caesar dispatched his lieutenant Labienus to deal with them, the Parisii not only burnt the bridges, but their whole fortified island township, and regrouped on the opposite bank. However, Labienus misled them cleverly by apparently leaving the scene and by taking advantage of a passing storm to get most of his troops across by boat at night. In the ensuing battle, the Parisii lost their leader, Camulogène, and were heavily defeated by their more professional opponents, although some 8,000 of them would escape to join Vercingetorix in what would prove to be the decisive campaign against the Romans. This would again bear out Caesar's insight concerning the ultimate inability of the loose federation of Gallic tribes to withstand a more organized opponent. For although Vercingetorix, pursuing a successful scorched earth policy, asked the Bituriges to sacrifice their capital, the present-day Bourges, they refused and suffered the massacre of 40,000 inhabitants. And when the Gauls were finally cornered in the fortified town of Alesia, near the present-day Dijon, they fought bravely but suffered a catastrophic defeat, saw many thousands killed or enslaved, and Vercingetorix dragged off in chains to Rome. Which was the end of the dream of an independent Gaul, and the beginning of a new phase in the checkered history of Lutèce. The city suffered a prolonged slump following that defeat, and despite its strategic and commercial potential, it would take a long time to recover. It was rather sidelined in relation to other Gallo-Roman towns, such as Lugdunum, Lyon, or Agedincum, Sens, each of which had a considerably larger population than the estimated 6,000 to 8,000 people in Lutèce. It was therefore only gradually over the next 3 centuries that the new Gallo-Roman Lutetia emerged, and since the right bank was marshy and subject to flooding, it developed essentially on the higher and largely unoccupied ground of the left bank. It was built on the standard Roman grid, with a dominant north-south axis and a lesser east-west one. The north-south axis traversed the Ile de la Cité by a new wooden bridge on either side and continued up the left bank along the present-day Rue Saint-Jacques. The island had a harbour on this southern side, and it may well have had some administrative buildings or a temple, but the emphasis was on taking advantage of the higher ground leading up to what would later be called the Montagne Sainte-Geneviève, where the Pantheon now stands in the present-day 5th arrondissement. This area was, in effect, the city centre, with a large rectangular walled forum containing a temple, a courthouse and a public assembly hall, as well as enclosed warehouses and shops, whose offerings would doubtless have included staples of Roman cuisine such as Italian wine, olive oil, shellfish and artichokes. There were 3 characteristically large Roman bathhouses open to the public at different points, served with fresh water by an elaborate aqueduct. These included the Thermes de Cluny, the ruins of which have been incorporated into the adjacent Musée de Cluny, the highly informative museum of the Middle Ages, although a section of the ruins is still visible from the Boulevard Saint-Michel. On view are the Cardarium, or hot pool room, and the Tepidarium, or Tepid Pool Room, but the most interesting and best-preserved room is the Frigidarium, or Cold Pool Room, which has intact architectural features, such as vaults and consoles, as well as fragments of wall painting and mosaics. The fact that the consoles, or supports, on which the barrel ribs rest were carved to resemble ships' prows lends support to the view that the bathhouse was probably built around the beginning of the 3rd century by the influential guild of boatmen, the so-called naut, or nauti in Latin. For although little is known of the activities of other groups, it is clear that the boatmen continued to flourish through income from the ongoing traffic on the river. The other notable Roman ruins, discovered to innocent general surprise late in the 19th century, are the Arène de Lutèce. There is, by contrast, no trace today of the modest-sized theatre that is known to have existed on the opposite side of the Boulevard Saint-Michel from the Cluny ruins, off the street named after the great French classical dramatist Jean Racine, appropriately enough, where matinee performances of a tragedy by Seneca or a comedy by Terence would have been performed. The theatre could not have competed with the vast Arène, an amphitheatre providing a more popular audience with gladiatorial combats, acrobats, and doubtless the occasional execution by feeding the victim to the lions. This was an enormous structure, seating some 15,000 spectators, or about twice the population, though there would also have been visitors coming in from nearby plantations. It is rather hidden away off the Rue Monge, and although there has been some restoration, little remains of its tall, tiered stand for spectators, so that it requires some effort to imagine the original roars of excitement. Today it is a free public park, frequented by the more dedicated tourist, older people enjoying the open space or the garden behind the stage, and teenagers displaying their acrobatic, cycling or soccer skills. In fact, the oldest historical monument in Paris, also to be seen in the Musée de Cluny, is the Pilier des Nautes, or the Boatman's Pillar, an elaborately carved monumental stone column offered to the Emperor Tiberius in the 1st century AD by the Guild of Boatmen. Discovered in 1711 during excavations under the chancel of Notre Dame, this is significant, since it invokes both Celtic and Roman deities, suggesting that a high degree of fusion of Roman and Gallic cultures was gradually taking place. Of course, they had parallel polytheistic systems, with each having scores of gods, demigods, and local gods, providing, as you might say, a god for every occasion, so that the addition of another god or two did not fundamentally threaten the structure of the Roman belief system. But the rising threat from monotheistic Christianity was a quite different matter. Not only did it challenge the existence of the gods, but by conferring upon individuals a one-to-one relationship with a new single god, it altered their whole sense of the meaning of life and threatened the social order. Slaves or vassals promised a heavenly time in the next life might no longer see the necessity of accepting a hellish time in this one. And although the persecution of Christians had already begun, the rising threat was dramatized by the martyrdom and its subsequent mythification of Saint Denis. Although he was for long confused with another figure of the same name, Denis or Dionysius, he was possibly a Greek who was sent from Rome as a missionary. Since Christianity was formally forbidden, he delivered his message on the outskirts of the city. Although he did not directly advocate political or social revolution, his message resonated, not only with slaves and many young people, but with others feeling resentful at the Roman presence. It was not long before the simple masses he conducted drew the attention of the authorities, and, along with his two acolytes, Rusticus and Eleutherius, he was imprisoned, interrogated, and condemned to be executed. And from that point onwards, his legend is written into the streets of Paris. Taken up to Mons Mercurii, or Mount Mercury, by the Roman road now known as the Rue des Martyrs, he was pressed three times to recant and escape death. But he refused and was beheaded in front of the temple on Mons Mercurii, which then became Mons Martyrum, now Montmartre. At which point the legend takes over to declare that at the age of 90 he picked up his head and walked 600 paces northwards to the burial place, which would soon become a shrine and eventually the site of the Basilica of Saint-Denis, designed to house the remains of the kings and queens of France, but which perhaps sits a little oddly today, not far from the Stade de France, in an area once known as a communist stronghold, which now houses a large Muslim population. This helped to establish the new religion in the popular mind, at a time when Rome itself was moving towards treating Christianity as the dominant religion of the empire. A significant shift was brought about by the Emperor Constantine the Great, who issued an edict putting an end to the persecution of Christians in 313. He also supported the first ecumenical council, the Council of Nicaea of 325, which brought together different strands of the Church in an attempt to resolve the Arian controversy, a dispute in which the Orthodox Trinitarian view that the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit were equal was challenged by the Unitarian view that since Christ was begotten by God, he could not be equal to God. There has inevitably been a debate about whether Constantine, if only because he killed his wife and one of his sons, was genuinely converted to Christianity, or whether he calculated in hard political terms that worship of a single god fitted in better with a cult of the emperor. With the empire under pressure, there might have been an element of both. And although the council marked a notable change of direction, the Arian controversy would linger on damagingly, while if any proof was needed that paganism was far from dead, it was provided by the arrival in Lutèce in 358 of Constantine's own nephew, the free-thinking young general soon to be acclaimed as the Emperor Julian. For by that time there had developed a major long-term threat to Roman Gaul in the form of the great westward migration of people that would straggle on from the end of the 3rd century to the 7th century. Due to a cooling of the more continental climate in the east, leading to poor harvests and the need to find more nourishing homelands, this would combine with the fall of Rome in the 5th century to change the composition and the face of Europe. The incursions had begun in the year 275, when Franks, Alemans, and others rampaged through some 60 towns in Gaul, wrecking, burning, and killing as they went. This had led the survivors in Lutèce to protect the forum with a walled surround, using stones from the wrecked buildings for the purpose, and to defend the bridges of the Ile de la Cité with fortresses. Yet this very retrenchment gave the city, although it was smaller than some other centres in Gaul, an enhanced strategic importance as a secure rearguard base from which to resist the invaders. By providing winter quarters for several Roman emperors, Lutèce would gain in status as a temporary imperial capital. The first and most notable of these was Julian, who enjoyed wintering and philosophizing for several years in his Dear Lutetia, which he describes as follows. It is a small island lying in the river. A wall entirely surrounds it, and wooden bridges lead to it on both sides. The river seldom rises and falls, but is usually the same depth in the winter as in the summer season, and it provides water which is very clear to the eye and very pleasant for one who wishes to drink. For since the inhabitants live on an island, they have to draw their water from the river. The winter, too, is rather mild there, perhaps from the warmth of the ocean, and it may be that a slight breeze from the sea is wafted thus far. A good type of vine grows thereabouts, and some individuals have even managed to make fig trees grow. It was, in fact, here, in the year 360, that Julian was declared emperor by his troops, although in the event it was an offer he could not safely refuse. Partly because of rivalries in Rome, he was ordered to give up half of his army so that it could be redirected to the east. The news not only caused panic in the population, afraid of losing its protection, but brought an angry reaction from the troops themselves, including Alemans and Franks, who had joined on the understanding that they would not have to cross the Alps. They confronted their popular young commander, demanded that he disobey the order, and finally proposed that he solved the problem by declaring himself emperor. Julian failed to talk them down, took a day to weigh the odds, including the probability it is suggested that they would have killed him if he had refused, and was finally acclaimed emperor. After which they happily followed him to Rome to enforce his claim officially. Two further emperors, Valentinian I and his son Gratian, would winter in Lutèce during the long struggle to prevent the incursions of the barbarians. These were not quite as barbarous as the Romans made them out to be, since they had organized societies and some of their members were integrated to the point of serving in the Roman legions. However, they were quite diverse and in conflict with one another, so that the situation was becoming increasingly chaotic, with the Alamans settling in Alsace, the Burgundians in Burgundy and Savoy, the Visigoths in the southwest, and the Saxons in the North Sea coastal area, while the Franks, a federation of Germanic peoples, would go on to dominate the area of present-day northern France, Belgium, and western Germany. Under pressure themselves from the Huns in the east, they would go on to attack successive Roman commanders and besiege Paris in the process. The end of Roman Gaul and the Pax Romana was in sight, and the era of the Franks, who would give their name to France, had begun. Yet the Christian Church was also expanding into the void alongside, if initially in competition with, the Franks, and Paris was about to acquire its patron saint in the form of Saint Genevieve, whose enormously tall statue now stands on the Pont de la Tournelle, leading on to the Île Saint-Louis. Born around the year 422, she was consecrated a virgin by the bishop at the age of 15, led an extremely austere life, and engaged in charitable activities. When Attila, the fearsome leader of the Huns, advanced on Paris in 451, and the terrified population was bent on flight, she insisted that prayer would deter him, and set about organizing resistance, so that when Attila bypassed the city and advanced instead on Orléans, her reputation was made. While it is probable that Attila did so for his own strategic reasons, there is no doubt about the reality of her contribution 10 years later, for when the city was subjected to a prolonged siege by the Salian Franks, led by Childeric, she broke the blockade by using barges to bring in wheat from the countryside. Even when Childeric's son, Clovis I, became ruler of northern Gaul in 486 to found the Merovingian dynasty, she attempted to influence him, and worked in conjunction with his Christian wife Clotilde to encourage him to convert, which Clotilde would not find easy. The Merovingians, who would rule over the Frankish lands for the next 2 centuries, were named after Clovis's grandfather Merovich, a semi-legendary figure who may or may not have been fathered by Neptune the sea god, and whose strength may or may not have resided in the exceptionally long hair that became an essential attribute for his descendants. Clovis, who clearly had a lot to live up to, was as ambitious as he was brutal, and appears to have modelled himself on the Emperor Constantine the Great. Succeeding his father as king of the Salian Franks at the age of 16 in 481, he proceeded to free Gaul from the remnants of the Western Roman Empire by defeating its final commander, Syagrius, at the Battle of Soissons in 486. Syagrius sought refuge with the Visigoths, but under the threat of attack they handed him over to be executed, while an ally of Clovis, who had failed to take part in the battle, was also eliminated. Clovis's next step was to set about enlarging his kingdom by systematically getting rid of competition from other tribes. Over the next 20 years, after neutralizing the Ostrogoths by marrying off his sister to their king Theodoric, he defeated the Alamans at the Battle of Tolbiac, routed the Burgundians near Dijon, and decimated the Visigoths at the Battle of Vouillé, by which time he had enlarged his Frankish kingdom and established it as a major force in Western Europe. He also wrapped things up by murdering every potential competitor in sight, including his own relatives, the king of Cambrai, along with his 2 brothers, and many other kings and blood relations, according to Saint Gregory of Tours, the 6th century bishop and historian. Gregory goes on to say that if Clovis then began to complain that he did not have a single relative in the world to help him in a crisis, he said this not because he grieved for their deaths, but because in his cunning way he hoped to find some relative still in the land of the living whom he could kill. Clovis was good on detail. Despite Clotilde's entreaties, Clovis took his time about converting. This was partly for personal reasons, since despite her prayers, their first son, whom she had secretly got baptized, died immediately, while their second son fell gravely ill and almost died in the same fashion. He eventually tried conversion as a last resort at the Battle of Tolbiac, when, under severe pressure from the Alamans, he gambled that if he won, he would agree to be baptized, which he finally was after the victory. However, he was always acutely aware of the problem presented by religion at the political level. For although Christianity had expanded considerably in Gaul, with many churches being built, the old Arian controversy, more than a century after being declared a heresy at the Council of Nicaea in 325, had not gone away and had left the church divided. Not only that, but Orthodox Catholicism, as opposed to the Arian version, was actually in a minority among the Frankish tribes. Clotilde herself had been an isolated figure when a princess at the Burgundian court. On the other hand, the Franks were becoming increasingly Romanized, Latin was becoming the official language for the state as for the church, and the Gallo-Roman governmental and legal structures remained largely in place. To the extent that he would have seen Rome as the prestigious model for an ambitious growing state, and insofar as he may have been understudying Constantine, he would need to unify the kingdom he had conquered in relation to its fundamental beliefs, and he would need to play it cannily. He had already been approached after the Battle of Soissons by a bold, but in its way flattering, letter from the Bishop of Reims, who advised him always to defer to the bishops and always respect their advice. If you are on good terms with them, your province will be better able to stand firm. Clovis saw this as a good deal, so long as he could bend the partnership to his own political ends, using the church both to legitimize his victories and to create support for him among the population. So he consulted with the bishops, built churches, if not quite one after each murder, as has been suggested, and before his death convened a council of bishops in Orléans, which passed many decrees on the duties and privileges of the clergy, the right of sanctuary, and the obligations of citizens. Clovis's adoption of the more orthodox Catholic form of Christianity, as opposed to the Arian strain of most other Germanic tribes, led to widespread conversion among the population, and eventually to religious unification across the Frankish domains. To crown his success, his pursuit of the Roman model of greatness was recognized by the Byzantine Emperor Anastasius, who granted him the title of consul, so that having chosen Paris, with its imperial echoes, as his capital, he could enter the city in glory, after which he proceeded to issue the Lex Salica, a code of law for the new dispensation. And although Paris had been rather marginal to his pursuit of power so far, it also gained in prestige from the fact that he chose to be buried in Paris at the abbey dedicated to Saint Genevieve, though his remains were later transferred to lie alongside those of other royal figures in the Basilica of Saint Denis. There is no doubt that Clovis, even by the standards of the time, was an unusually brutal operator. There is also no doubt that he is a highly significant figure in the political and religious history of his country. For many French people, especially those who believe in the true France, or la France profonde, the history of France begins only with Clovis, whose name, incidentally, would evolve into the very royal Louis, a common name for French kings up to the 19th century. As President de Gaulle put it, The decisive factor for me is that Clovis was the first king to be baptized. My country is a Christian country, and I count the history of France as starting with the accession of a Christian king bearing the name of the Franks. Certainly, Catholicism would gain greatly over the next two centuries of Merovingian rule from this new partnership between church and state. Paris alone would gain around a dozen churches over the period, including a basilica on the Montagne Sainte-Geneviève, later rebuilt to become the very secular Pantheon of today, and of course the future necropolis of French royalty, the Basilica of Saint-Denis. Many miracles would be recorded and many saints created, to the point that the characteristic literature of the period became Lives of the Saints, such as that of Gregory of Tours. Significantly also, the increased importance of the church would combine with the Roman imperial posture to ensure that Latin would become the basis of the French language in the future. However, Clovis, after unifying the Franks and getting rid so ruthlessly of possible competitors, seemed, from our modern perspective at least, to have thrown it all away. His kingdom was divided on his death between his four sons, thus creating four provincial kinglets and inaugurating a pattern of concentration and fragmentation that would plague the area for several centuries. Power would be dispersed to the point that it could effectively be taken over by local or regional aristocratic figures, as by the so-called mayors of the palace, while kings would often be reduced to token rulers, or be dubbed, as some of them were, the roi fainéant, or do-nothing kings. In this chaotic situation, Paris retained its symbolic value as capital, a trophy to be squabbled over at times, and the place where the church councils were traditionally held, but it had been reduced, as one study puts it, to a sort of common capital of a fictitious Merovingian state. The blockage was eventually resolved to a large extent by two significant mayors of the palace, a giant of a man called Charles Martel, or Charles the Hammer, and his short younger son, duly dubbed Pépin le Bref. Charles not only re-established central control over the squabbling provinces, but is widely considered to have saved European civilization by his victory over an invading Muslim army at the Battle of Tours in 732. Pépin, ambitious to rule as a proper king rather than as a mayor of the palace and to be legitimized by the church, had the nominal claimant to the Merovingian throne dispatched to a monastery, had himself anointed by Archbishop Boniface in 751, and then had himself approved by the Pope in 754. This was significant as a deal whereby he had the monarchy sanctified by the Pope in exchange for undertaking to reform his own church, which was in some disarray, with clerics getting secretly married or bishops building up their own personal estates. And it was with this pact that he initiated the Carolingian dynasty. Yet if Pépin had himself anointed in Paris, he paid little attention to the city, while his son, Charlemagne, who increased the connection with Rome by being crowned by the Pope in 800 as emperor of what would be known as the Holy Roman Empire, chose Aix-la-Chapelle as his capital, leaving Paris even more sidelined. Moreover, the fragmentation continued when Charlemagne's successor, Louis the Pious, died, and the empire was fought over and divided into three, with West Francia, including Paris, falling to Charles the Bald, who did not choose to live in Paris at a time when it was under severe pressure from Norman raids. It should be appreciated that while all these monarchical manoeuvres and broad historical changes would obviously determine the framework within which Paris would develop, the living conditions in the city had been harsh. The streets were unsafe at night for want of lighting. People lived in often crowded wooden houses, which, since they also used firewood for heating, were all too subject to fire, as in the Great Fire of 585. The houses were also dark inside, since glass was still a novelty associated only with kings and cathedrals, making it necessary to use waxed cloth or some such substitute. For food, they were heavily dependent on bread, and there had been frequent famines, as in 588, 640, and 651. The Roman aqueduct having fallen out of use following the sacking of Lutèce in 275, the water was polluted, and the muddy streets served as a channel for rubbish and excrement. People were therefore subject to a range of diseases for which there was no medical provision, even after the creation of the first hospital, really a charity refuge, the Hôtel Dieu, founded by the Bishop of Paris in 651. The situation of women would have been particularly difficult, with no independence and their existence legitimized only as virgins or mothers. Above all, with no education and with information coming to them in the form of myth or rumor, people knew little or nothing of the world beyond. It was a time when you needed to believe in miracles. However, no miracle was forthcoming from Charles the Bald when the Vikings came calling in their tall ships in 845 and started pillaging the town. He bought them off, which obviously only encouraged them to come back for more, so that there were regular damaging raids over the next 40 years. Eventually, in 870, Charles was driven to replace the Grand Pont with a much stronger stone-based bridge that could be closed to enemy ships, while the two bridges were reinforced by fortresses called Châtelet, the larger one of which has left its name on the Place du Châtelet of today. Fortunately also, the old Gallo-Roman wall surrounding the Ile de la Cité was strengthened in 885, just in time for the Parisians to crowd in with their worldly wealth and their saintly relics to resist a fresh onslaught by the Vikings. The monk Abon describes in a heroic poem how they held out against attacks by catapult, ram, and flaming longboat, showering the Vikings and their painted shields with arrows, stones, hot water, pitch, or whatever they could find, until the Vikings contented themselves for a whole year with ravaging the town outside and the surrounding countryside, while waiting to be bought off again, this time by Charles the Fat. The price of all this heroism for the population, whether in lives lost through an epidemic, if not through the fighting itself, or through the wreckage of their homes, was high. Meanwhile, the gradual fragmentation of power continued through another serious epidemic that hit the city in 945, until succession to the throne became a matter of dispute to be resolved by election. Significantly, it was the Archbishop of Reims who manoeuvred cleverly to have Hugues Capet elected King of the Franks at Noyon, some 60 miles from Paris, in 987, while Hugues returned the compliment by then having himself ceremonially crowned by the Archbishop in Reims. So far, so good. But he was surrounded by competing regional rulers, and he controlled, in practice, only the Ile-de-France and the Orléanais. He then took a strong precautionary step towards guaranteeing the future of his line by having his son crowned as his successor. Although he paid no particular attention to Paris, his eccentric son, Robert the Pious, who succeeded him in 996, and who got himself excommunicated at one point, began to restore the royal palace on the Ile de la Cité and built a church on the site of the present Sainte-Chapelle. So, at the end of this first millennium, what could a rather exhausted, dilapidated and marginalised Paris expect from this Capetian dynasty, which, after this shaky start, would nevertheless endure and largely shape France over the next three centuries? Chapter 2. Medieval Paris, Cultural Capital of Europe. It was not until the 12th and 13th centuries that Paris ceased to be a mere crossroads, as Jean Favier puts it, to become a proper capital city. For in practice that could not happen until the Capetian kings established a stable kingdom from a jigsaw of different areas. The royal domain itself consisted of the Île-de-France and the Orléanais, with the addition, temporarily, as it would soon turn out, of the Duchy of Burgundy. There were the appanage, or domains resulting from the practice of dividing estates among the sons, which were hereditary, but could revert to the throne if the incumbent had no issue. There were large provincial fiefdoms, such as Flanders or Guienne, which were formally part of the kingdom, but were virtually independent. And then there were the increasingly large domains owned by the church. Since all this led to local private wars and widespread dissension, it was not an easy task for kings to strike a balance between these disparate elements, make the right marriages, choose the right alliances, raise enough money, and fight whatever battles were required to enlarge and unify the kingdom. The need for a fixed capital, indeed, the very idea of one, would depend on their success. Meanwhile, they were the itinerant kings, moving from place to place and trailing the royal archives in the baggage train behind them, at least until these were seized by Richard the Lionheart in 1194 after the Battle of Fretival. This complex situation would not make life easy for the two kings who followed Robert the Pious. Indeed, the reign of Henri I, who ruled for almost 30 years from 1031 to 1060, itself came out of a typical territorial dispute. He had combined with his younger brother Robert, with the support of their mother, in an abortive revolt against their father 5 years earlier. But on the king's death, his mother supported Robert, which left Henri to buy off his brother with the Duchy of Burgundy, which their father had fought so long to acquire. Although he neutralized a threat from the Count of Flanders by marrying his daughter, his two attempts to invade Normandy ended in failure, and although he did acquire the County of Sens, this could not compensate for the loss of Burgundy. Since he also became involved in unhelpful disputes with the Holy Roman Emperor and with the papal legate, who objected to the selling off of bishoprics, it is fair to say that his most notable contribution to Paris was to have his remains interred nearby in the Basilica of Saint-Denis. This, at least, was more than his successor, Philippe I, would do, apparently feeling that he was not deserving of the honour, since he had conducted an extended quarrel with Pope Urban II and did not respond positively to his call in 1095 to join the First Crusade. His reign was indeed complicated by the fact that he repudiated his wife Bertha on the grounds that she was too fat and married Bertrade de Montfort, which led to him being excommunicated more than once since he could not keep away from her, and hardly helped his relations with the church, especially since he too was raising money by selling off church domains and offices. He was frequently involved in trying to clamp down on overmighty regional barons and suffered a serious loss of prestige when he was defeated by his own vassals in 1079. He did, however, have some successes. He had long been seeking to contain the ambitions of his vassal, the Duke of Normandy, William the Conqueror, who became King of England in 1066. And he now defeated him in battle, and came to an agreement whereby William stopped trying to conquer Brittany. He also gained the small but strategically important county of Vexin, and bought the domain of Bourges, but what his reign mostly illustrates is the extraordinary difficulty of kingship amid the chaos and violence of the time. Paris was about to endure this yet again, just 3 years into the reign of Philippe's successor, Louis VI, ruled 1108 to 1137, when the Comte de Meulan took advantage of the king's absence in Orléans to invade the Île de la Cité, pillage the royal palace, and smash the bridges to block a counterattack, leaving the inhabitants to take on the aggressors by themselves. The fact that they did so quite heroically did not entirely compensate for the damage done to an already damaged city. So how, given the disturbance of the time, did Louis VI, known both as Louis le Gros, the fat, and Louis le Batailleur, the warrior, although he became too fat in his 40s to lead from the front in battle as the warrior, begin the process that would lead to the extraordinary transformation of the fortunes of both Paris and the kingdom over the next two centuries. He did it both by understanding the basic problem and by working closely with the church in the form of the Abbé Suger of Saint-Denis. The Holy Roman Empire, neither holy nor Roman nor an empire, as Voltaire famously quipped, was a concept or an aspiration rather than a developed reality, and the whole of Western Europe at this time displayed a hodgepodge of competing entities, kings, dukes, counts, and bishops of various degrees of size and importance. This was reflected in the kingdom of Louis le Gros, where the lack of any authoritative hierarchical order between these entities inevitably led to almost bewildering confusion. Louis exemplified this situation himself, since he was now also Comte de Vexin, and therefore notionally the vassal of the Abbé de Saint-Denis, his own chief counsellor. Such confusion was a recipe for ongoing conflict, with these dukes and knights sallying forth from their new, initially wooden castles to assert or enlarge their rights in this uneasy, squabbling free-for-all. The church had long been concerned about this, and had tried firstly to introduce a truce of God, which would forbid fighting on certain days of the week, thereby accepting fighting on other days of the week, and secondly, to deflect the violence towards the world outside Christendom. And both feature in the passionate call of Pope Urban II at the Council of Clermont in 1095 for Christians to join the crusade to liberate from the Muslims the holy city of Jerusalem. O race of the Franks, we learn that in some of your provinces no one can venture on the road by day or by night without injury or attack by highwaymen, and no one is secure even at home. Let us then reenact the law of our ancestors known as the Truce of God. And now that you have promised to maintain the peace among yourselves, you are obliged to succour your brethren in the east, menaced by an accursed race, utterly alienated from God. The holy sepulchre of our Lord is polluted by the filthiness of an unclean nation. O most valiant soldiers, descendants of invisible ancestors, be not degenerate. Let all hatred depart from among you, all quarrels end, all wars cease. Start upon the road to the Holy Sepulchre to wrest the land from that wicked race and subject it to yourselves. While the Pope's plea would have some general effect, and while the kingdom would gain prestige from the fact that the call to arms had been made at Clermont, Louis le Gros was still faced with the task of putting down the robber barons of various degrees who were imposing tolls upon merchants and pilgrims, terrorizing the peasantry, or pillaging churches and monasteries. He confronted in battle such offenders and pretenders as Hugues de Puiset, Hugues de Crécy, and his own half-brother Philippe, as well as the so-called raging wolf Thomas de Coucy, a notorious torturer. He dealt with nobles who had allied themselves with Henry I of England, gathered a coalition to counter a threatened invasion by the Holy Roman Emperor, responded to appeals for help, and largely established not just the unchallengeable authority of the king, but his role as protector. He also gained the important Duchy of Aquitaine by marrying off his heir, the future Louis VII, to Eleanor of Aquitaine, who would have her own major role in history. Louis le Gros also, unlike his two immediate predecessors, grasped the necessity in this situation of working closely with the church, and especially with the Abbé Suger of Saint-Denis. Nor was it simply that this could glorify and give a religious status to the monarchy, thereby constituting it as the ultimate authority in a scattered and violent kingdom. It made sense at the simple practical level, if only because with churches, monasteries and other religious institutions sprouting all over the city, the church had become the largest landowner in Paris. These institutions often possessed large plots for the growing of food or keeping of animals, and even owned subsidiary properties. For example, the Abbey of Saint-Germain-des-Prés enjoyed an area as large as the present-day 6th and 7th arrondissements combined, as well as a scattering of properties in the surrounding countryside. It even ended up with its own prison when the Pope freed it from the bishop's jurisdiction. Again, as the only source at that time of organized education, the church could provide monks to staff offices of the state, as it could also provide work for serfs, servants, builders, and craftsmen in such fields as jewellery or tapestry. Louis recognized that it was an essential part of the fabric of the society, as Suger recognized that the throne was essential to the security and advancement of the church. Although he also served as advisor in other areas, Suger's main contribution was the reconstitution of Saint-Denis as the holy place of the monarchy. The abbey had been immensely rich, but had suffered from the Norman invasions, and the behaviour of the monks had become notably loose. So, in addition to freeing the serfs, he re-established the rule of abstinence and the practice of silence. He then set about the gradual reconstruction of the basilica, designing the façade to echo the Roman Arch of Constantine, with three wide portals, before going on to take a significant step towards what would become known as the Gothic style, with a new chancel. The novel features now involved the pointed arch, the ribbed vault, the ambulatory with radiating chapels, or the flying buttresses making possible the insertion of large clerestory windows, all pointed to the aim of the Gothic style to flood what had traditionally been dark buildings with light. And when the nave was rebuilt in the Gothic style a century later with two magnificent rose windows, the picture would be complete. Saint-Denis, with its new basilica, would provide a fitting resting place for past kings and for the royal symbols, would draw pilgrims to view relics and bathe in its inevitably mythologized history, and would help Paris to become not only the home of the hitherto itinerant kings, but the greatest city in the kingdom. For this to be achieved, however, the two long-serving kings who followed would need to establish the strong and stable national framework that would enable the city to develop. Louis VII, ruled 1137 to 1180, hardly achieved that, although the compensatory factor was that he appointed the competent Suger as regent when he went off on the Second Crusade, and Paris now became the effective capital for the conduct of national business. It is hard not to feel a little sorry for Louis, for circumstances were initially against him. Deeply pious and bent on becoming a monk, he became king by accident when his brother died. He had been married off to Aliénor, or Eleanor d'Aquitaine, by his father, whose interest lay in acquiring wealthy Aquitaine, rather than in the 15-year-old Aliénor, so the question of compatibility did not arise. The pious Louis was married to this beautiful, feisty, impressive young woman, who was used to the more relaxed ways of the court of Aquitaine, and who complained that she had thought she was marrying a king, but had only married a monk. She shocked the court with her independent, extravagant ways, and it was probably to keep an eye on her that he foolishly took her with him in 1247, along with a bevy of her ladies, on the Second Crusade. However, the crusade turned out to be a disaster, and he suspected her also.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.